All the manufacturing processes that are used are classified into four categories that help in converting a raw material into a final product. The first category of processes are called primary shaping processes. Here we create shapes. The basic shapes are created in these procedures. These include casting, molding, composite forming, or powder metallurgy. All these procedures come under primary shaping. So the basic purpose of this is to create a primary shape. The second set of processes are called secondary processes, in which we do two things. One is we modify the shape, and other one is we enhance their properties. So when we say modify the shape, we mean we add additional mechanical feature to this. For example, we have created a cylinder and we want to add a threading to it. So that becomes a modifying the shape. And also we take a plate and then add a hole. This is also called machining, which adds a hole feature into the component. So this is modifying the shape. In addition to physically modifying the shape, the secondary process also enhance the mechanical properties. So these are nothing but the heat treatment processes. Heat treatment processes change the mechanical properties of the component. For example, it may increase the strength, or it may decrease the yield point of the material, or it can harden the surface. All these procedures come under secondary processes. And the third set of processes are called joining processes. Here, because the components are joined in these processes, because a complete machine cannot be done using a single process. So when a component is made, these multiple components are joined together by various joining methods. For example, if it is a simple fastening, or it could be a welding or riveting. And if it is a composite material, you may also use adhesive joining also. So these are the third stage of processes. And the last one, the processes which give final touch to the component. So this include a polishing, plating, anodizing, and etc. So these are roughly the classification of processes that are used in converting a raw material into a final product. So primary shaping, secondary process, joining, and finishing. Let's get into the details now. One of the popular primary shaping processes is casting. In casting, a liquid is poured or forced into a mold or a cavity where it solidifies by cooling. The liquid used in casting is of less viscous material. That means it easily flows. So just to pour a liquid, it will automatically fill all the gaps and it solidifies after sufficient time. Now, very rare cases, we may have to use a small pressure to fill the cavities so that you can avoid any voids being formed. In casting, we will study the procedure called sand casting. First one is, we'll say sand casting. The name sand casting comes from the fact that the molds used are made of sand. So we've got two molds, that is top mold and bottom mold. When these two molds are joined together, so here we get a cavity or a space. When this cavity is filled with the molten metal, so when molten metal fills this cavity and solidifies, then we get a cast product. Here we are not using any force or pressure because of gravity. When you pour the material, liquid material, it just fills into this gap and forms a casting. And next one is die casting. As the name indicates, here we use dies. Dies are nothing but molds, usually made of metal, very strong. And here we have got a plunger and cylinder arrangement. So a liquid is poured here into this gap, okay, and this plunger pushes that liquid into a cavity created by the dies. So when these two dies, that is fixed die and moving die, are joined together, they form a cavity. This portion is a cavity here. So the cavity is filled by the liquid metal, and upon solidification it creates a cast product. Now, and the third one is investment casting consists of series of wax patterns attached to a central post and creating a tree structure as shown in this diagram. Okay. Now onto this structure, a refractory slurry which includes a fine silica and binders is poured. So once it is poured, it is allowed to settle down for some time and it solidifies. And this entire setup, that is including the wax pattern and the reflector slurry, is heated. So when we heat, two things happen. One is, because of heat, the wax gets melted and it is allowed to drain out from the system. So the wax is removed from the system. Now we have a refractory surrounding with a cavity inside. In this cavity, a liquid metal of required material is poured into it. So when the liquid metal is poured into the cavity so created, it forms its own cast. Later, after sufficient curing, it is shaken, it's broken out, that is silica mold is broken out and the cast material is removed. So now in case of low pressure casting, the main purpose of this is to have a controlled atmosphere during the cooling of the liquid metal. Here, this is the cavity, the regular mold cavity. What we do is, we use some pressure and a temperature, and because of pressure, the molten liquid fills the cavity from bottom to top. So unlike the earlier procedures where because of gravity it starts filling from top to bottom, here we fill from bottom to top. Molding is similar to casting, except that the liquid used here is a bit viscous. So hence, usually we need an external pressure to make it flow. We have a hopper. Okay. And in this hopper, we pour the granules of polymer. Polymer pieces are poured and this is fed into a cylinder and screw arrangement. So as the screw rotates within the cylinder, these granulars are sheared and crushed, and it is simultaneously being heated. Okay, because of shearing and crushing action, the solid granular particles of the polymer get converted into a molten liquid, and this molten polymer is injected into a die or a cavity within the mold. So upon cooling, this will turn into cast. Blow molding, we have a die, the inside of which is the required shape. Now a blank is provided at the center and a gas pressure is blown into it. As the gas is blown into this, it expands and touches the inner surface of the die and thus takes the shape. So thus a cast is made. Similarly, in case of polymer extrusion is similar to injection molding. Here also we have a hopper in which you pour pieces of polymer, and then you crushed and sheared inside a cylinder like structure. Only difference is because earlier in case of injection molding, it was getting filled into a mold cavity, but here it comes out in terms of an aperture whose cross section is the required cross section of the component we desire. So a long slender like structure comes out, which in is case of thermoforming, we can have two subtypes in this. One is vacuum forming, another one is pressure forming. In vacuum forming, what we have is, we have a sheet, so that is a polymer sheet, and then through this this whatever inner surface we see is your required shape for us. So when it is heated and it is sucked from bottom, so here we are sucking it. Because of sucking, here there is a empty vacuum, and this sheet gets the shape of this particular inside surface. What that is, either you can suck this, or in second case what we do is we actually pass a pressure, high pressure, and so that this sheet will move down and get attached to the surface. So that is vacuum forming and this is pressure forming. In deformation processes, we apply large amount of force in deforming the material. Though material is solid, because it is at high temperature, it is in soft condition, hence So you can apply force and mold according to the required shape. So because of the temperatures, we classify them into three different categories. If the temperature is between less than 35% of the melting point temperature, okay, if it is less than 35% of the melting point temperatures into TM, so we call it as a cold process. It's called cold process. If the temperature is between 55% to 85%, okay, we call it as a warm deformation process or warm forging process. And if temperature is more than 0.85 or more than 85% of the melting point temperature, we call it as hot forming or hot forging process. Okay, so this is general. So let's take out the first one called forging. Okay, in case of forging, we have a lump of metal. Okay, this is the lump of metal which is pressed between two dies, so upper die and lower die. So because of temperature, it has become soft. When you apply force, and it will take the shape of this die, and it takes the required shape. Then we have rolling. In rolling is similar to the rollers that you observe in a roadside sugarcane machine, except that here the cross section is as per our requirement. If you see the right hand side diagram here, the rollers are shaped that the required cross section is obtained when the billet of material is passed through these rollers. Okay, so a billet of bar is introduced here and it passes through this roller. It comes out with reduced thickness, and also the cross section will be according to the cross section of this roller here. So by varying this cross section, you can vary the cross section of the output material. That is about rolling. And then we have extrusion process. Extrusion process is basically you are pushing a material through a small aperture. Here we have direct extrusion and indirect extrusion. In direct extrusion, what we do is the molten or the billet material is here, and you apply a large amount of force through the ram into this cylinder. So when you apply force, this material is oozing out, okay, as an extruded product. So it's a prismatic product in the sense the cross section is same throughout. So the cross section of the output material depends on the aperture of the device used here. So this aperture will determine the kind of output, the cross section you have. If it is circular, you will get a cylinder with a circular cross section. If it is rectangular, the output material will also have the rectangular cross section. So in direct, we use the two different naming here. The direct extrusion is the force applied and the direction of the output are in same direction. So you are applying force from left to right, and the forged material is coming out from left to right. Whereas in indirect extrusion, you are applying force from right to left, whereas the material is getting extruded from left to right. So this is the extruded material. So, but otherwise also the methodology remains same in both the cases. Now we'll go to a spinning. Spinning, here a spinning disc of ductile material is shaped over or pressed over a wooden pattern by repeated sweeps of the smooth rounded tool until the metal takes the shape of the pattern. So here, as you can see, we have a original blank. Okay, it is being rotated, original blank. It has got no bending so far. So as it is rotated, gradually the tools are used to press this blank, okay, unshaped blank, over this particular chuck. Thus it can take the shape of the pattern. That is about spinning. In powder metallurgy processes, we join the particles of material together by applying pressure and heat to form a solid mass. Powder metallurgy processes consist two steps. First step is to give a primary shape by compressing the powder into a given shape, and then that particular shape, whatever shape is obtained in the first process, is taken out and put in a furnace and heated. The second process is called sintering. Okay, so in this we'll take the first one, die pressing and sintering. In die pressing, the ceramic powder or metal powder is taken here and it is compressed between the dies. When you compress between the dies, the metal powder takes a basic shape. Okay, and then this basic shape is then brought into a furnace and heated there. Because of heating, it becomes solidifies and gets the strength. Similarly, we have hot isostatic pressing. Here, what we do is we take a powder in a thin preforma and is heated and compressed by an external gas pressure. So as we say, isostatic means equal pressure in all the directions. So here we have a basic preforma. For that we have, and inside we have a powder of the metal, and then we apply a lot of pressure and heat pressure basically, so that it gets compressed, in this case in the form of a spheroidal structure, and then it is taken out and heated in a furnace to get the required shape. Third one, we have powder injection molding. This procedure is similar to the injection molding processes that we have studied earlier, except that instead of the polymer we used earlier, here we use powder and binder mixture, and it is passed through this screw and cylinder arrangement, and it is pushed into a cavity formed by the mold. Okay, and this mold, the powder is now compressed and it has taken the shape of this mold, and then it is taken out and heated in a furnace, which we call it as sintering. Once sintering is done, it gets the required strength. In slip casting, the powder is mixed with the liquid, preferably the water. So this is poured into a mold which is porous in nature. Okay, this, the mold, what you see here is a porous. So the metal particles stay here, whereas the water escapes into the porous mold, and from there it is drained and collected outside. So what remains inside is basically a material, the powder. And it has taken a particular shape, and this is then heated in a furnace, that is what we call it as sintering, to get the required shape. Composite forming methods are the methods used to form composites. A composite is a combination of two or more materials combined at the macroscopic level. Basically, in a composite, we have two types of materials. One is called a fiber. Okay, this fiber, it is like a thin thread like structure, a long fibers, and they are usually strong in their strength, I mean the strength is large. And we have a resin, a jelly like, a gum like structure, which is liquid mostly, and both resin and the fiber, they form the major parts of a composite material. So when fiber and resin are mixed, and when they are cured, curing means basically either you heat it for a certain temperature or you just leave in the room temperature itself, it will become solidified and becomes a hard part. So that is the usual composite manufacturing procedure. The first one is, we have a filament winding procedure. In a filament winding, we have a cylindrical structure called mandrel. On that, you just we got series of fibers. So the fibers are made up either glass, or they are made up carbon or a Kevlar. It's a commercial fiber, and the one of these fibers is wounded over this cylinder. Of course, there is automated by computer numerical control machines. So it just wounded over, and it, and meantime they are impregnated with this resin. So jelly like gum like structure. So when you wound over it, they'll get attached to the mandrel. And after the winding is complete, they are cured at room temperature or in a oven. So when they are cured, it becomes a cylindrical structure. Later, they are removed from the mandrel to generate a cylindrical structure. So whenever we want a cylindrical structure, such as a pressure vessels, we use a filament winding procedure. Then we go to the basic and commonly used procedure called hand layup or spray layup procedure. In hand layup, simply the mold is the required shape here. And you can either use a continuous fibers, the fibers are continuous in nature, or you will use chopped fibers. They are cut into small portions. These are chopped fibers. Chopped means cut fibers. So these are long fibers. So either chopped fibers or long fibers are used. In this diagram, we have shown a chopped fiber. So resin and chopped fibers are mixed and simply spread over this area to the required thickness. So once the required thickness is obtained, you just leave it for curing either in room temperature or in a oven. And this entire the material shown here, which is a combination of both the resin as well as the fiber, gets hardened and required composite is generated. So if you are using long fiber, simply you can just press this over this mold and then resin can be added later. So many times you use a device called roller to press it properly and get the composite. Then we have a procedure called pressure bag molding or vacuum bag molding. Here it is similar to hand lay procedure, except that instead of manually pressing, we just use a high pressure gas, and we using the by applying the pressure, we push the resin and fiber on the inner surface of this mold. So only thing is, the because of the gas pressure, the application of pressure is uniform throughout the mold. And then we have pultrusion. Pultrusion is procedure in multiple layers of fibers. Okay, these fibers are impregnated in a bath, resin bath. So this is resin impregnated liquid. So when it passes through, the outer surface of the fiber is now wet with the resin, and it is passes through a heated die, and then layers of fibers and resins are passing through this and compressed in a die and heated in a die. And when they go to this roller, and all the layers are compressed to create a thin structure like this. So these are different layers. So you'll get it something like a roller rolling procedure, except that here your series of layers of composites are there, and then we cut to the required shape using the cutters. The last type of primary shaping method is additive manufacturing, also called as AM. It's a new and popular method of manufacturing. Here, this uses a computer controlled tools to build shapes layer by layer. And because it uses computers, it can create complex shapes. So in this, the first one is your deposition modeling procedure. In deposition modeling, a solid body is created by layer deposition of a polymer droplets on the platform. That means here you have platform, and from this nozzle kind of thing, a polymer droplets are poured in. For example, if you want a cylindrical like structure only along the circular, you just keep on placing this polymer, it gets added up and forms a cylinder. So the actual shape obtained is determined by the movement of this particular nozzle like structure or head. Then we have what is known as stereolithography. It is similar to the deposition modeling procedure, except that the polymerization, this resin used, is photosensitive. So the curing can be done only in presence of light. Therefore, a laser beam is passed over this workpiece. After laser beam is passed over, it becomes solidified due to its photosensitive reaction. And then we have what is known as direct molding modeling. In direct mold modeling, a sand, for example, you have shown here a sand mold. The sand mold is built layer by layer by selective spraying of binder from a scanning printhead. So this is your printhead here. By movement of this, accordingly, we'll get the bonded sand. In laser printing, that's the next method. Laser metal deposition, called as LMD. In laser metal deposition, powder or wire is fed here, as shown here, onto the surface, and selectively using a laser beam, it is sintered, that is heated. So gradually this powder, once it gets sintered, becomes hard and required shape is obtained. In secondary processes, the material has already got some shape. We want to add some features such as threads or a hole or reduce the thickness. And this machining processes are generally material removal processes, unlike the additive manufacturing process where we added material layer by layer, whereas in this machining process we remove the material. Therefore they are called material removal processes. For example, if you take the first case, turning and milling, here a sharp hardened tool tip cuts the material, so it chips away the material. In case of turning, so for example we do it in lathe machine, we just remove the material, the diameter is reduced. Whereas in case of milling, the action process remains same except that we are reducing the thickness of the material. So if you go to plasma flame cutting, here a very strong high temperature arc is generated between the tungsten electrode and the workpiece, and because of the very high temperature arc, that is plasma arc, the material gets eroded and hence cutting is possible. So if you go to the electric discharge machining, also called as EDM, here electric discharge between a graphite electrode and the workpiece, which is submerged in a dielectric such as a paraffin, removes the material from the workpiece to get the desired shape. So in the last one is water jet cutting machine. It's just here the water is used to cut the material. Water contains some abrasive materials and water is impinged with very high speed. So this high speed water along with its abrasion will remove the material and cut the workpiece. And water jet cutting produces a very smooth cut surfaces. In the secondary processes, we have other type of processes called heat treatment processes, where we heat and cool the material to obtain required mechanical properties. Basically here we change the internal microstructure to get the required properties. So we define heat treatment as an operation or a combination of operations in which the process involves heating and then soaking and then cooling. So we heat the component at the specific rate and then soak at that particular temperature and then cool it at particular rate to obtain a desired microstructure. So by heat treatment we change the internal microstructure of the material and hence change the material properties. So there are basically five heat treatment processes. More or less they appear to be similar. There are small differences in each of them. The first one is hardening. Ferrous metal is normally hardened by heating the metal to a required temperature and then cooling rapidly. Here we rapidly cool the material by putting just throwing that into into oil or a water, or it could be a brine. So this produces a strong material. Now sometimes we go for tempering, because in hardening procedure that we discussed above, there will be an internal stresses developed. So these internal stresses are harmful, because already there is a stress. When you apply a load onto that, they will get added up and may produce the failure. So to remove these internal stresses, we go for tempering. So in tempering consists of heating the metal to a specified lower temperature and then permitting the metal to cool in, say, still air. So when you do this, the internal stresses are relieved and the material becomes less brittle, which otherwise is very hard because of the hardening process that we have done earlier. And the third process is annealing. Annealing is again used to relieve the internal stresses and also to soften the material and to make it more ductile and to refine the grain structure. So in this process, the metal is heated to prescribed temperature and it is held at the temperature for some time and then cooled back to room temperature. That is about annealing. And then we have normalizing. Ferrous metals are normalized to relieve internal stresses that are produced by machining and forging and welding. So in the earlier machining process, due to the operation of the tools and high forces on the workpiece, there will be some internal stresses produced, and to relieve that we are using a normalizing process. In normalizing, what we do is it is achieved by heating the metal to a specific temperature, and this temperature is higher than the temperature that is used in hardening and annealing that we discussed earlier. And later, when it is heated to that temperature and it is soaked in a metal until it is uniformly heated, and then it is cooled in still air. The last procedure is case hardening. Case hardening, as the name indicates, it is basically used to harden the outer surface, the surface of the workpiece. So here this is done to produce a resistance to the wear. So if the surface is strong, it produces a strong resistance to wear. It involves sometimes infusing additional carbon, so that is known as carburizing, or it involves adding a nitrogen into the system called as nitriding. So there are many other processes, but these are the common processes used to case harden, that is to make the surface strong. Joining is done to add two or more work pieces or join two or more components. Joining is achieved by various processes such as fastening, welding, and riveting. For example, if you go to the first one called metal welding. In metal welding, two metals, whether similar or dissimilar metals, are joined by applying a high temperature. So when you apply high temperature, the material, both the materials will get into molten state, and then in liquid state they get joined together on solidifications. So sometimes a third material called filler material is also used, which acts as a binding material. So then we have polymer welding. In polymer welding, heat is applied to the polymer components, which are simultaneously pressed together to form a bond. So we have got polymer sheets. Okay, here we apply temperature as well as pressure, okay, through this hot bars, and then they join together. Similarly, if you go to adhesives, adhesives are used to join two surfaces. For example, a film of adhesives is applied to one surface, and then which is then pressed onto a mating one. So you have got a surface, a glue like or a gum like structure is nothing but the adhesive, and then another layer is put, and then they'll join together. And the last one is fastening. Fastening is joining up two components or work pieces by either using a screw or using a rivet or using a staple, or it could be snap fits. Even a push through and push on snap fastener also used as shown in the diagram. And then we have finishing processes. Finishing processes are processes that remove very small amount of material so that it can give you a proper finishing. So here we use a honing stick, as we can see here, honing stick, or we can use a fabric wheel. So the relative motion between the workpiece and the honing stick and the fabric wheel will remove the small amount of material and giving a smooth surface. And we have electroplating. In electroplating, metal is electro deposited onto a conducting workpiece. So for example, in this diagram, so metal molecules from this material go and stick onto the surface, and the outer surface of this particular workpiece will have the properties of this metal, which is being electroplated onto this. And we have third one, that is induction hardening. Here we use electric induction to produce the surface layer of the workpiece, which is very hard. So here it is, material is heated and then quenched. So the heating is obtained by induction hardening. So in case of laser surface hardening, a surface track is melted and then cooled rapidly by conduction to give hard tracks. To summarize, we have studied four different processes. Okay, the first one was primary shaping, so in which we have studied casting, molding, deformation, powder methods, composite forming, and additive manufacturing. In we saw casting, a liquid metal is poured into a vacuum and then it is solidified. Molding also is similar process, except that in molding we have very high viscous liquid. In deformation, we applied a large amount of force to bring the necessary shape to the workpiece. In powder methods, we took a powder of a metal and then joined and then later heated to get the required component. In composite manufacturing, there are so many methods. We just studied simple methods in which we had a pieces of fiber and we mixed some resin into it and then cured it, that is left it in atmosphere for certain temperature, and then it got solidified. In additive manufacturing, we just added layer by layer material and created the required complex shape. So in secondary process, we studied two types. One is the machining process. It could be producing a turning procedure or producing a hole or threading. And in second type of process, we studied heat transfer, in which we enhanced the properties by changing the microstructures. And then we studied joining procedures. In joining procedures, we studied welding, fastening, riveting, and adhesive joining. So adhesive, of course, we used for polymer sheets. And then finishing, that is removal of the small material from the surface, was achieved using polishing, plating, and anodizing, as discussed. Thus, these four steps or kinds of procedures are used to turn a raw material into a final product.